Greetings from Excellence. It is a moment of great privilege and honor for me to extend a hearty welcome to all of you on behalf of Excellence. We provide future-ready classes from 8 to 12 standard to achieve excellence. Our effort is to make them compatible in this competitive era and to extract the best out of them. But we don't only confine ourselves to curriculum only. The path of life teaches us lessons in every stage. A life becomes more beautiful when it is colored with various shades of ups and downs in life. Ups and downs in life brushes up these shades in our life by mentoring us. Excellence is trying to bring out those colorful lives where success has been met against many hurdles. Here we bring such personalities whose deeds become our inspiration, our motivation. Learn from Life is an innovative and inspirational setup by Excellence team. It is a free meeting series where we invite topmost personalities around the corners of India to learn from their life. Today, we have with us Dr. Pankaj Koparde, the Dragonfly Man of India and an evolutionary ecologist. Dr. Koparde is actively involved in several citizen science projects and outreach through popular media. He is an TEDx speaker, Prakriti Fellow, DST Young Scientist, and a published Marathi writer. He completed his master's in biotechnology from Savitribai Phule Pune University and went on to study ecology and evolution for his doctoral thesis. For his PhD, he worked on the wolves of central India and came up with insights on their evolution and geographical distribution from Salim Ali Center of Ornithology and Natural History. He has also a former research fellow at ICER. Now he is working as assistant professor at School of Ecology and Environmental Management. So let us learn from Dr. Pankaj about his career journey and what to expect when you follow the path less traveled. Thank you, sir. It's over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Goswami. Thank you for the kind words. I will straight go to the presentation. I hope many of the students, prospective students, are listening to this talk, and this will be live also. So I think I'll just straight forward go to the presentation. I hope my screen is visible to everyone.
It's visible, sir. Yes.
All right. Thank you. So I will be primarily talking about a career in wildlife science, and I'll be narrating my story. And I hope the young generation here will try to relate it with, if they are into passionate about wildlife sciences or sustainability studies, or they want to make a change on ground about climate change and so on. So this helps. So I won't go into details of my own bio, but just a few lines that I am an ecologist. I work primarily on owls and dragonflies. You can see both the taxa in this picture. Well, that's me over here. And I have separately labeled my name because you should not confuse it as an owl. But you can see owl and dragonfly in this, the second row. There's also a picture of a forest and there is a jeep in it. So that's one of the picture from our field site. And there's a group of people were, sitting on a rock. So that's some of the lab members that I, work with. We have a small setup at MIT World Peace University called Chaturullu Lab. And there are many students working with me who are having varied interest in biogeography, diversity distribution, urban ecology, and so on. I'll be briefly talking about some of these subjects, and I'll also, let you know what exactly is happening in the field and why, people like me are still surviving. I'm also an admin of many citizen science groups, as Dr. Goswami mentioned. I will also be briefly talking about what is citizen science and why there is a sudden surge in these kind of sciences. So let me narrate my life story, life history first. And this is a very small part of my academic sort of, you know, career. So during 2005 and 2004 and 5, I completed my 11th and 12th. And, you know, just like many of you here, I was struggling to find out what exactly I want to do. And there were two major options, of course, you know, everyone has this, like engineering and medical. Well, in my case, there were multiple options available. And for instance, the first was engineering, the second was medical, the third was engineering, and the fourth was medical, and so on and so forth. So you see, I mean, it was nothing different than anyone else's. But when I was in studying 11th and 12th in biology, you know, there was this class at Nashik where I did my junior college in Maharashtra. And I met a very nice mentor, Dr. Acharya. And he basically taught that, you know, there are a lot many things that one can do when you study biology. It's not only about medical sciences. So there sort of, you know, it triggered my interest in various, you know, apart from medical sciences field. And I think that's one of the important, you know, milestone, I would say, in my life. Well, I was into bird watching, into nature observation since my childhood. My childhood, I spent mostly in Konkan region of Maharashtra, which is very rich in biodiversity. And as a school kid, I used to, you know, go out, wander in different, you know, hills and mountains, and go swim in the, you know, in the river and so on. So basically, I was pretty much connected to nature as a child. And during the education choice, I basically got to know that I want to do something in biology, definitely. But still, there was a black box. That's why this, you know, you can see the black box. I did not really know what exactly I want to do. So I studied and I basically applied to various types of colleges. And eventually I went into a biotechnology course. So I did a master's in biotechnology. And this was a very prestigious university and very prestigious institute, Institute of Bioinformatics and Biotechnology at Pune University. Very well known for the staff and the students that come to this particular place. So I took a choice. I basically went on for a 5 years long course. It was after 12th, you know, MSc course. So basically I don't have a bachelor's degree as such. I just have the 12th HSC certificate and then I have a MSc degree. I don't have a bachelor's degree as such. So I spent 5 years in this institute. It's a wonderful institute, and a lot many, you know, my colleagues are doing really great work in various fields of sciences. Well, at the end of my master's degree, I really realized that I don't want to do technological stuff. I wanted to do more of pure science, pure biological sciences. And in that, I wanted to focus more on ecological sciences. That's where I basically approached to some people. I you know, learned a little bit about what other researchers are doing into ecological sciences. And then I got to know that this is the right path for me. And that's where I had some information available when I, you know, took the choice. So that's why I have shown it in a blue box, where I had little information, not very, you know, huge amount of information, but still I knew that if I dive into ecological sciences, I can definitely find a career path. So I did that. I took a leap of faith. And my first assignment was in 2010, when I just, you know, passed out MSc Biotechnology. I got associated with one of the professors, and we went to Eagle Nest Wildlife Sanctuary in Arunachal Pradesh. So that was the field site. That's the picture of my field site, or, you know, where I worked for a few days. And, you know, one by one after another, I basically went on from one job to another, primarily for learning purposes. And I explored very beautiful landscapes and very beautiful people and, you know, animals and so on. So just after Arunachal Pradesh stint, I went to Andamans for my next job, you know, where I studied some of the swiftlets, which nest inside caves. So I spent really amazing time in Andamans. It's, you know, you all know Andaman as a tourist place, but there's so much of biodiversity on these islands, which is unexplored. So I was there for some time. After that, I came back to Maharashtra, and in my next job, I studied 2 years. I studied the Northern Western Ghats landscape. And this was again, you know, another type of a, you know, a time gap where I learned a lot many techniques in the ecological sciences, which basically equipped me to think about scientific questions, which I can ask in my PhD thesis and so on. So after completing my master's in biotechnology, I actually took some, you know, around 3 to 4 years of time, just understanding what I want to do, what is ecological sciences, how I can contribute, what are my skill sets and so on. So I basically trained myself 3 to 4 years. And then I went on to a PhD program where I had a well-thought scientific question, which I was answering. There were a lot of funds available. And, you know, we did systematic work and so on. And beyond PhD, then there is slightly a different career path, which I talk about in just a few minutes. So this was 11th and 12th, my master's, and then my post-master early career. And after 2013, I went into a PhD program. So I would like to say that there are ample of opportunities for young people who want to explore ecological sciences or wildlife sciences, conservation sciences, and so on. So there are different names that people use. And you visit different landscapes, you visit, you know, different areas where there are actually something that's going on. I mean, there is an urgent need of researchers in the field. So there are a lot many experiences one can get and one can write about. Beyond 2013, I went into my PhD program and I was mentored by some of the, you know, really great minds in ecological sciences. So my thesis, the long title of my thesis was Molecular Phylogeny and Comparative Biogeography of Owlets of India. So you can see that on the right hand panel, there are some species of owls. So these are actually small sized owls. And if you look at them, if you're not into bird watching, you will really get confused with all these, you know, they look very similar, right? So the one of the questions that I was asking was, are they really different species? And, you know, when did they diversify? Like, when did they speciated? What is the evolutionary biology like? Where did they come from? Okay. And how they are geographically distributed? What are the different threats to these species? So these are some of the questions that I asked during my PhD thesis. And we collected data and so on. And I worked with an array of institutes, some of the very you know, prestigious institutes, I would say, in biological sciences, such as National Center for Biological Sciences, ICER. Then, you know, I was hosted at Salim Ali Center for Ornithology and Natural History, and I was registered at Manipal Academy of Higher Education. So basically, I also collaborated with multiple people, multiple institutes, and worked in different areas across India. So the main question that I explored during my PhD thesis was based on these three different species of owls. As you can see that they look more or less similar. And if you could, you know, focus on the maps given below. So each species has a different geographical distribution. The red area basically shows the total area, total extent where the species may occur. As you can see, the forest owlet, the first species, it has a very narrow distribution, you know, only few dots, red dots, whereas the other two species, they have a much wider distribution. So an obvious question would be like, why this happens? Like, you know, they are looking similar, perhaps they're having similar ecological requirements, their diet might be similar, right? Their sizes definitely are, you know, more or less similar. So why there is such a distinction when it comes to the distribution, the geographical distribution? For in fact, one of the owls, like the forest owlet, is an endangered species, and you know, you can see that the distribution is so narrow, their population are also perhaps dwindling, so we don't know. So, you know, why this happens? So this is a question that I asked, and then I thought that just looking at the species in the today's context may not really answer the question. So you have to slightly go back in time. You have to study their evolutionary biology to understand how they must have diversified, in what conditions they diversified. And are they really coping up with the current, you know, changes happening? So there are landscape level changes, meaning a lot many landscapes are getting converted. You know, we know that cities are expanding, right? Or agricultural fields are expanding in many places. So what kind of pressures, you know, these expansions have on the forest, right? So that's one. Secondly, climate is changing. Everyone is talking about that. So climate change is, you know, something of a reality in today's time. And what kind of effects the changing climate will have on the forest, on the people, on the animals? That again a question. So, I mean, we thought that perhaps there are all these different factors coming together and influencing the geographical distribution of the owls. So it means when you study something in the field, you know, you need to also study its history. Now, history will be perhaps is for 10 years, 20 years back, 100 years, 200 years, you know, back in time. But when you study wildlife, you need to study their evolutionary history also, which might be million years back. Okay, what has happened? And then current, are they really into, in the really facing any threats and so on? So that was the primary question that I asked, and I did some work. So I will not go into the technical details of the PhD thesis because, you know, I mean, that's a completely off topic right now, but I'll just show you some pictures from my field work. And this is a very special picture for me because this is the first close-up picture that I took of the forest owlet after I started my PhD work. I had seen forest owlet earlier, you know, during just however, this is a very memorable picture for me. So I spent a lot of time just watching this bird. And after the, you know, the end of the interaction, I thought that I should just take a picture. And this is how an endangered owl looks, you know, at you. So this is something, you know, I just wanted to share it with you. And some more pictures from my field work. So we had a very small team, and, you know, we used to roam around in the forest of central India, watching the birds, trying to understand their ecology and so on. And this is typically, you know, how it looks like when you are into wildlife sciences. So there are various tags on these careers. Like some people might call yourself as field biologist or wildlife biologist, conservation biologist, or, you know, sustainability professional and so on. So there are like different types of designations you may get, but the life is here, like the life is in pictures. And when we do field work, it's not just about the bird that we are looking at, but also the community. So many times wildlife biologists, they do not mingle much with the, you know, community because that's slightly different part of, you know, the wildlife. However, whenever we used to get time, when we used to get, with the community, they know a lot about wildlife. So in fact, these are some of the pictures again from the Central Indian landscape, where I just want to show you that fieldwork is, I mean, it's really fun. At the same time, it is also very difficult because you are at a remote area. Many a times you have to completely rely on you know, instruments which you perhaps would never use, like GPS and so on, because mobile networks do not work there, and you need to find your way in the forest. Many times nobody is around to ask for directions and so on. And you have to completely take care of your team as a team leader. You may also get lost. But I would like to make a point here that, you know, the kind of fear that people relate with the forest, that forest animals may attack you. Like, you know, you are in a tiger landscape, or you are in a bear landscape, or elephant landscape for, you know, for that matter, and they will attack you when you are in the forest. I think that's not really true. Animals generally keep a distance from us, from humans. Perhaps we are, I think, one of the most disgusting species on the planet, but animals are generally shy. They do not want to encounter a human. So Jim Corbett, you know, used to write in his books that when you enter into a forest, the tiger sees you first. So they know that you are here. It's just because of, you know, several things that we do as humans. But animals generally know that you are in their landscape, and they generally keep a distance. So if you are, you know, pursuing a career in wildlife science and you are expecting that you should fear forests because there are wild animals out there, I think that fear is baseless. However, we used to fear a lot of humans, you know, other people who might, just interfere with our work or, you know, mess it up. But yeah, wild animals are pretty cool in a sense. So these are some of the pictures from the field site. Some more field pictures. So here I am sort of for owls. And when I see an owl, then we set up, we use a particular method called mistnet to capture the bird. So this is primarily because I was working on the, genetics of the birds to understand how they have evolved. And that needed me to catch some of the birds and, extract some blood so that I can extract DNA from it. So you see that wildlife sciences is not only about, just going in the forest and observing the birds. There's a lot of things happening currently, which I think most of the people are unaware of. There is a huge and a very broad field of conservation genetics, where you use genetic data to decipher evolutionary histories, population level status of species, and then you propose certain management measures by which the species might do better in the coming few days. Okay, so this is something that again people miss out. So I just would like to focus on that too. So this is how we used to set up our mist nets. So you can see that there are people who are setting up the mist nets. So mist nets are basically very fine nylon mesh, and they are slightly black in color. So when you set them up across, the birds, when they fly across, they generally don't see it because of that mesh, and they get trapped in the mist net. So when you see, find the bird, you take it out, you put it back in a cloth bag, and then take it to your temporary lab, which you have set up in the field. So this is our temporary lab here, and we were measuring the bird beak length and so on, and then we used to take a little bit of bird blood. Just like there is this diabetic patient testing, just like that. We used to take a couple of drops of blood and then we used to extract DNA. So this is how this whole process looks like. So suppose we have got a jungle owlet. So, there's a bird watcher's grip. There's a birder's grip. So you have to, hold the owl or hold any bird in a particular manner so that it is, not under stress, and then we used to take up the blood. And interesting thing about owls is that they can move their head in 270 degrees. So it's almost like the owl can completely turn its head up to a level, and that's really amazing. So when you hold the owl in your hand, it will always be looking at you, whether you turn it anywhere. So quite cool creatures owls are. So while we do the mist netting, apart from owls, many other birds used to get captured, and we used to release them because we were not really looking for all these birds. But there's so much of diversity, right, in the birds, and these are some of the birds that one can get into the mist nets. So after collecting the blood, then we used to come back to our laboratory in Bangalore. We used to conduct certain reactions on that sample to get genetic sequences. And basically, during this whole process, you need a lot of coffee. That's why the coffee is pictured on my slide. So lab work is, again, very interesting process. It is whole, you need to learn a little bit. So here, I would say that my master's, discipline. I did my master's in biotechnology. And during that course, I learned already a lot of lab techniques in microbiology as well as biotechnology and bioinformatics, which I could completely use during my PhD thesis. So this was not something new for me. I had already done it in my master's, and I was just applying it from an other perspective, from a wildlife perspective. So I think that was something very unique about this whole work. And my previous training helped me a lot. So that's what lab work, and then you come up with the results, analyzing the data and so on. So just a couple of results I'm going to show, and I'll just quickly move to the next part because there's a lot to talk about. So first I did a phylogenetic tree, and this tree basically, looks something like this, where you have all the different species arranged in a manner of their evolutionary relationships. So if two species are very close and they are sharing one common node, then they are called as sister taxa. Okay. So my first question was about the forest owlet and, you know, other owls, whether they are different or not and so on. And it turned out that the spotted owlet, Athini Brahma, marked here in red, and the forest owlet, they were actually falling in a bigger clade. However, they were different species. So this was a very important result that I received. And I also dated this day, this whole tree, meaning I basically assigned values of in time. Okay. So if you want to read it through the time perspective, this whole tree, these areas where my cursor is right now, these are areas of today. As you go back from here to the left, you are going back in time. Okay. So basically, as you go back in time here, if you go to the strategy node, so this is around, I guess, around 40 million years back. 40 million years back. That's a really long, you know, time. So with this whole sort of calculations, we got to know that the owls that we are interested in, they diversified around 3 to 5 million years back. And when we studied that particular time period and whatever literature was available, we got to know that 3 to 5 million years back, there was a period called Pliopleistocene climatic fluctuations, meaning globally there were, you know, lot many climatic changes happening. So we thought that perhaps the Pliopleistocene climatic fluctuations, they must have been a sort of a force for diversification of owls that we are seeing. So if that is the case, then it also means that whatever climatic fluctuations are happening, you know, presently or in the near past, they must have also affected the species equally, right? So based on that, we did some more calculations and, you know, some more modeling and all that. And we got to know that, you know, with all our, you know, analysis, basically we understood that there has been climatic fluctuations in the past, in the recent past, and that have really, you know, shaped up the geographical distribution or the suitable climatic areas for all these different species of owls. So for example, if you look at forest owlet, the first map here where my cursor is right now, and if you look at the timeline, it's 140,000 years back. 140,000 years back. So at that time for forest owlet, there was a very good amount of suitable climate across the Indian subcontinent. Okay. However, if you look at slightly younger, that's 22,000 years back, the climate changed, and because of which the climatically suitable areas for the forest owlet, they shrank. Okay. And again, then they expanded, again they shrank, so on. So basically, whenever there was a major course of, you know, time period where the climate must have changed, these species basically showed very different responses. So for forest owlet, it was really, I think, stressful and very terrible time across. However, for spotted owlet and jungle owlet, it has been a progressive expansion. Okay. So basically, if I want to summarize this whole, you know, diagram, I would say that the forest owlet, which is an endangered species today, it has, you know, gone through multiple cycles of expansion and reduction as a response to the climatic fluctuations happening in the past. But in case of spotted owlet and jungle owlet, they have been responding positively to the climatic fluctuation and they are expanding as such. Okay, so that explains me why there might be in this geographic distribution that I see today. But that also means that the current climate change will also further affect all these owls. So that's a big concern, right? So, you know, these are the type of information that you get when you study the evolutionary biology of the species in a systematic manner. So that was a little bit about what I did my PhD, and I don't want to bore you with more technical stuff. So I'm just going to jump to, you know, the next, you know, beat of it. So slightly, I'm just going to go back a little bit in timeline. And so I mentioned that as a child, I was in an area which was full of biodiversity. So this is how the village where I used to study looked like in the monsoon. And that's the road. So this is the road to my school. So I used to take this road every day, while going to the school. And I used to walk 3 kilometers daily down the hill to the school. And during this time, 3 kilometer time, whatever I used to spend, I used to see a lot of birds around, a lot many things around. And that triggered my interest in nature as such. I think that was the main trigger. And eventually then, it percolated, and perhaps later on, I must have thought that if I enter into this field, I will do the best. And, I would say that really helped me. The second taxa that I worked parallelly was dragonflies and damselflies. Collectively, they are called as odonates. And since 2009, I'm studying dragonflies more often from as an independent researcher. So basically, I was not really associated with any organization as such to study dragonflies, but it was just something that I found, and I thought that, this is something of my cup of tea. I can, photograph them. I can study more about them. I'll learn more about them. I can identify them and so on. So I'll also talk a little bit about why dragonflies and, why such a different combination. Like, I've been talking about owls so far, and suddenly I'm jumping onto dragonflies. So in fact, many of the ecologists that you see around, they generally work on birds, and that's because there is a lot of data on birds, a lot of many field guides, a lot of literature on birds, and it's a natural choice interested in nature to first explore birds. But eventually everyone gets to, explore more, and then they basically choose their favorite taxa to work on. So similarly, in my case, it was first birds, then I specifically focused on owls because that's something that, is really something of a favorite of mine. And owls are just amazing because the way their adaptations are, their evolution has taken place, the kind of characters they show, and the whole taboo about owls in our society. So, that just makes them a very interesting taxa to study. And second is dragonflies, where very little information was still, available for many years. But, now there's a lot of amount of information available, and not many people working across India, a lot many good scientists working on dragonflies, but still more of a neglected taxa as compared to many other insects group, that you see around quite a lot. So in fact, many of my audiences, many of my students, come back to me and say that we have seen dragonflies. We call them helicopters. It's a very common name that many people use, in India. So yes, helicopters, because, the way they fly. In fact, the way they fly inspired helicopter design. Okay, so it's actually the other way around. So quite interesting taxa to work on. And this tremendous diversity in terms of shapes, sizes, and colors. And they're just amazing. When you start exploring the dragonflies and damselflies, you will realize that fly around on the wetland, just sit on a shore, a river shore or a lake shore, and just observe the dragonflies flying around. It's just something very soothing kind of a experience. Perspective, odonates are quite interesting because they evolved around 325 million years back, and that's a really, really long time. And they were one of the the early insects which took flight, which had wings. So they are also called as ancient insects many times. So odonata evolution is also really something that many people study. They are very voracious predators. They kill other insects. So in an insect ecosystem, they are a top predator, and they're quite agile. They're quite fast. You will find them flying around very quickly. They have very good reflexes. They have a very high efficiency of killing. For instance, a dragonfly has an efficiency of 95%, meaning if it is trying to catch a fly 100 times, 95 times it will succeed. In case, that's the dragonfly, but the other predators like the tiger or cheetah or the leopard, they have around 50% efficiency, meaning they fail 50 times every 100 times they try to catch a prey. So that basically in a way tells you like how well designed as predators they are. They also have very strong and very interesting flight mechanism. The most interesting character about the dragonflies and damselflies is that they can fly backwards, which is not very common in many insects, because insects have something called an appendage which basically blocks it. So the reverse gear in layman language is not present in most of the insects, but in case of dragonflies they can do it. So that makes them even more cool. And they have this very amazing mechanism, the way they reproduce. They lay eggs in the water, and then the larva, from the egg the larva comes out, it stays in the water for a few days. It will hunt, it will become a predator within under the water, and then eventually it comes out and becomes a dragonfly. So this whole life cycle is again very interesting. So one question that many people ask me is, why do you study dragonflies? Why do they matter to us? So first of all, dragonflies, they have a very tremendous aesthetic value, and they are charismatic insects. In many areas, especially Southeast Asia, they are into many art forms. So they have replaced butterflies actually in many places. In many poems, you will find the mention of dragonfly. In many Hollywood movies also, you will have mention of dragonflies. So if some of you have watched this movie called Before the Rains, there is a mention of dragonfly, like how dragonfly symbolizes freedom and tolerance and power. In fact, all these characters are there. You can see them in this, insects. From an ecological point of view, they are top predators of the insect world, and they help in nutrient cycling by killing many other insects. So in a way, they disintegrate the insects into the nutrients, which are eventually fed by, fed to the plants. From an anthropocentric point of view, they are very good pest controllers. Because they eat other insects, they can also control the mosquito population. In fact, there have been some experiments where the dragonflies were purposefully released into the, a particular setup where they calculated how many mosquitoes they eat and whether the mosquito population really decreases or not. So dragonflies, as adults, when they're flying, they can catch adult mosquitoes. And when dragonflies are under the water as larvae, they eat the larval mosquito forms, because mosquito also have this larvae underwater. So they eat that too. So in both the, different areas, underwater as well as above the water, dragonflies kill mosquitoes. And not only that, eat a lot of other pests, for example agricultural pests, which might be of very harmful for various other things. And in some places they are also eaten as delicacies, especially in the Southeast Asia and parts of Northeast India. Dragonfly wing structure is quite unique, and it has inspired the wing structure of the helicopters, or the design of helicopters in the first place. Secondly, the wings of many areas, like the windmills. Okay, so this whole wing structure is taken from the dragonflies. So there are a lot many things that really are attached to the dragonflies, and that's why studying them, understanding what threats they are facing today, and conserving some of the species is very important. And there is this very urgent need of conservation in today's scenario. This is not something that we as ecologists want to say, because it sounds very good and sounds something that we really matter. However, there is scientific studies which have shown that we are in a crisis situation. In fact, the world has entered into the sixth mass extinction, and there are documented evidences that prove that we are into the sixth mass extinction. So the overall time from the perspective of ecology is a very depressing time. We are living in a very depressing time, because there are so many issues which are associated with changing climate, as well as this continuous loss of biodiversity that we are facing. However, ecologists like me and many others, we are doing our bits to do more research and with changes we can conserve the species. So in this cartoon, it's quite self-explanatory that few years back, if you lit a lamp, then you will find many insects gathering on that lamp. However, in today's time, you hardly see something come into the lamp. So this is actually something that has been observed in Germany, and where there was a long-term study of 25 years in area in Germany. There was around 75% decline in insects, and that is a huge amount of insect decline. So why do insects really matter? Because they are the fundamental layer in the food chain or the energy pyramid, right? So when insects are declining in the protected areas, and so much so, like 75% decline, that's really huge amount. So in fact, you're talking about this whole fundamental layer, one of those fundamental layers completely going out. Okay, so that's really bad. So the world is into really, a crisis situation right now. And how do you really relate this? Like, why this is happening? So the main reason is the habitat loss. And habitat loss is something of, more of a in many places, wetland areas are degrading very fast, and that basically results into species going locally extinct. And in case of dragonflies, it's they are completely dependent on the wetlands. So if the wetland systems, they are at a loss, then the dragonflies will also eventually will be lost. With many other taxa, not only insects, but many other species like mammals and birds, amphibians and so on. And we have definitely entered into a very, unprecedented times. And that's why there is a very urgent need of understanding these today's world's problem and how we can mitigate them as a generation. So people, many different ways to basically help us out. So one of the ways is to pursue a career if you're really passionate about it. Okay, I mean, it's not for everyone. It's only for those who can stay there till the end and who can actually make a difference, right? So if you're really passionate about it, you can pursue a career. Otherwise, you can also help researchers like me or many others by depositing data on a common platform by becoming a citizen scientist. So what do you have to do to be a citizen scientist is very simple. You take pictures of wildlife or insects or animals wherever you go, and then you post them on a particular common web platform. And once this data gets accumulated in different parts, researchers like me or others, they can extract the data and you can use it for our research or for understanding conservation requirements in a particular area. So becoming a citizen scientist is also something by which you can contribute data. If you are really passionate, if you really think that you are the right person for the field, you can definitely join either at a bachelor's level, there are no specialized courses. However, in the master's level, there are courses where you can train yourself to be an ecologist and you can contribute in the field. I'll also a little bit talk about the course that we offer at the end of this session. So we have established a citizen science project called Dragonfly India. This is primarily for the people who are interested in dragonflies, and they can come together and post their data on a particular platform called Dragonfly India. And this is the timeline of the Dragonfly India. So in 2005, we started it. In 2009, we migrated it to Facebook because a lot many users started using Facebook. So we went to the Facebook, and then basically the group grew. And in 2014, we started a physical meeting called Dragonfly India Meeting. This is an annual event where a lot many people attend this. And we basically train them in the art of dragonfly watching and dragonfly research. So this has grown really big. This whole group has become really large. And in 2017, we became so large that people from neighboring countries also started participating with us. So basically, we became from Dragonfly India, we got converted into Dragonfly South Asia, because a lot many countries from South Asian region joined hands. And so that was a transformation. We also mentioned DSA on a TEDx platform when I talked on it. And in 2020, last year, because of the lockdown, we could not do an annual meeting. So we started a virtual meeting. And in fact, this year also this virtual meeting will happen, in which there is this very long series of talks by experts, we are also partnering with WWF Dragonfly Festival, which is happening in August. So we'll also be there. And we also started regional talks, because many a times people do not understand English, you know, well. So we also started talking about dragonflies in various regional languages. For example, I talked in Marathi, my colleague Sinhalese language, or Bengali, Gujarati, Kashmiri, and so on. So there was a wide variety of even Malayali, Malayalam, Tamil, and so on. So a wide variety of languages we covered last year. Perhaps this year also we will have similar kind of things. And just to give you a statistics of why we are doing it, is because on Dragonfly South Asia, we have around 9,000 people who listen to us on, you know, almost daily basis. So you can just imagine, if 9,000 people across the South Asia are contributing data, then how much data, you know, is, you know, getting deposited on a citizen science portal? How much is the potential of the data to understand, you know, various patterns in the distribution and the seasonality and so on? So this is just a picture of me talking about citizen science on a TEDx platform. The physical meetings in South Asia, some of the pictures where we dragonflies, learn more about them, going into the field, having the panel discussions and so on. And this is just a glimpse of the citizen science data that we have collected in the last few years. So you can see that the whole India's map, and wherever you see pixels is basically from where we are getting the data. So, you know, from Andaman Nicobar Islands, from Sri Lanka, and many parts of India, especially this part. So it's basically people who are, they're just interested in dragonflies. It's not that every researcher is contributing, but anyone who is interested in dragonfly, you can simply take a picture and you can post it here on the iNaturalist project. And then researchers basically will give you an ID, what species it is and so on. It's quite interesting. It has grown a lot. I have some students from the School of Computer Engineering, who are doing BTech Computer Engineering. They are helping me with some dragonfly diversity informatics projects, where we are making some applications, you know, some apps where people can list down the dragonflies, or they can identify dragonflies based on artificial intelligence, you know, machine learning kind of a framework, and so on. And coming back to where I am right now, so I am associated with a university in Pune, MIT World Peace University, and we have a School of Ecology and Environmental Management where I teach as an assistant professor. And here are some of the pictures from that school, and you know, some students, external students. So there was a time before pandemic that we had this, you know, privilege to be together as a group. However, now it is not right now. Hopefully the future scenario will be different, but I'll just give a brief glimpse of what this school is about, and you know, what do we do in that school, who all can join the school, and you know, if you want more information, you can contact me. So the school is a School of Ecology and Environmental Management, and we offer a master's program in Ecology, Society and Sustainable Development. So there are various types of courses in this program, mainly foundation courses, core courses, specialization courses, and there's a lot of emphasis on the field work. So I talked a lot about field work, like going to the forest, talking to the people, you know, observing wildlife, doing lab work, coming back to the lab and doing it. So all this is basically, you know, in our course, we have a lot of emphasis on it. There's also United Nations Sustainable Development Goals for 2030, given by the United Nations. So this course basically picks up some sustainable development goals, the 3rd, 10th, 11th, 13th, 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th, basically which relate to the wildlife sciences, conservation sciences, and sustainability, the idea of sustainability. So in this course, there are also some skill-based courses, skill development courses, which we routinely use as a wildlife, you know, biologist or conservation biologist, for example, statistics. Now, you might think that when you, you know, take admission into biology course, then your connection with the mathematics is completely gone. And this is a very wrong notion in many students. So if you do not like mathematics, if you hate mathematics, that's not the reason you should join a biology course, okay? Because, I mean, nothing, in fact, no science in the world can, you know, can do without mathematics. So you need to know mathematics. It's not that you have to be an expert mathematician, but even when you're doing wildlife sciences, when you are doing ecological sciences, mathematics is a very integral part of this science, okay? So don't think that when you go to medical sciences, you are completely your mathematical, you know, mathematics, no relation with the mathematics. So it's not that, okay? So it's better to accept it at this level, 11th and 12th or, you know, bachelor's level, understand why we need it and actually work on it, because it's mathematics and statistics can give you data or analysis in such a way that you can actually, you know, claim what you are talking about. You can, your statement, you can be backed out with a lot of values and data. So it's important, really important, okay? I mean, there was a time when in my 10th, I really hated mathematics, okay? I did not really prepare for it. However, later on, when I understood that mathematics is something that's very important, then I started learning it myself. And when I learned it, then it was quite fun. I mean, it's not that dreadful or difficult or, you know, disturbing or nightmarish kind of thing that I always thought is, but actually it's not, okay? So if you find a good mentor, if you yourself do it, then I think it's not really going to be a tough choice. Don't worry about mathematics, it's going to be really fine. Mathematics and statistics both. In fact, many ecologists heavily rely on data and do a lot of analysis. So going to the field, collecting data is very fun part, and we all like it. You know, it's also hard, but it's very fun. And many times people go and collect data. But when they come back to the lab, when they come back to the desk, many of the people don't know how to analyze data. And that's where, you know, there is no conversion of your research. Why do we do research? Like, why do I go in the field and study owls? It's basically, I want to say something. I want to understand about their biology, about their evolution. I want to decipher what can happen when the climate changes. You know, what conservation measures I should put on ground. If I do not analyze my data, there's no point of all this, you know, there's no point just going to the field and taking pictures and coming back to the desk, right? So that's why mathematics and statistics is very important. In fact, just now I mentioned about diversity informatics. So there is a field called ecological informatics or eco-informatics. And it's a very, speedily growing field. All the citizen science data can be used for this. There are a lot many things happening on the informatics front in the wildlife sciences, and many people use R programming. So it's just basically for statistics purposes, but R programming is again something that we teach in our course. Ecological informatics, again, a part of it we teach in the course. Not many industries depend on the ecologist for doing environmental auditing, okay? So industry or many residential area, residential complexes, okay, they have to do an environmental audit, they have to do an environmental impact assessment before they begin their project, okay? And for that, they need people who understand biodiversity or ecologists. So these are professionals who actually go on the site and study the diversity and come up with recommendations where the harm can be minimal. Is also a growing field of science communication. So you might have seen that you must be getting a lot of forwarded WhatsApp messages. And many times these messages, give you a very wrong information, not validated, right? In fact, many news channels, they provide a lot of wrong information when they talk about science, okay? So it means that there is a very urgent need of people who understand science and who can also be a good journalist or a good communicator. So there is this wide there's this wide array of people who understand different sciences. So someone might understand physics very, you know, much better than any other sciences, might be a physicist who then converts himself or herself into journalism and so on. So there is also this very important thing called science communication, and not only for the adults, but also for the kids, because science has to reach to everyone, but the media may differ or the way you deliver it might differ, right? So there's again this urgent need of science communication, which is covered again in our course. We also teach landscape ecology. So landscape is, as you can see here in this picture, it's not only about wild animals or the people or the river or the, you know, hills or the industry or the residential areas. It's basically a mosaic. So everyone is interacting with each other, and that's how the landscape is formed. So how you understand these ecological interaction, how do you predict how the landscape is going to change? What interventions are important? So all these things come into the landscape ecology and change detection analysis. So all these things are also covered in our course. And in government, or if you are pursuing a lawyer or, you know, these kind of careers, there's a separate section for biodiversity laws, and you need to be aware of these. So as an ecologist, you need to be aware of biodiversity laws. So that's also covered in this particular course. So in fact, many things that you must have thought, or perhaps many of the people who are watching this video might not be aware of what exactly wildlife biologists do. So apart from going to the field, going to the forest, observing animals, taking notes, observations, apart from all these, we do a lot, many things, you know, multiple things actually. And a major chunk of these things are basically to understand this whole process, why certain species occur in certain places, why they are not in other places, right? And what are the different aspects by which you can conserve the species? So if you think that wildlife biologists are what are shown on the Nat Geo or Discovery Channel, that's completely wrong. Mostly they are the photographers, a wildlife photographer. That's a different field altogether. So you need not be a researcher. Wildlife biologists and wildlife photographers, they're slightly, you know, different. They're not the same. So as a career, what as a wildlife biologist or an ecologist you would do when you go to the field is basically a lot, many, many things than, you know, taking the pictures of the animals. Okay, so we hardly take pictures of animals or our own pictures. We mostly do observation kind of, you know, study and then data collection. So with our school, School of Ecology, we have a lot, many connections with multiple organizations, and there are a lot of collaborative projects we are doing with all of them. There are also some scholarships the university offers. So if you're interested in a master's program in ecology, society and sustainable development, then you can definitely think about this one program. And we are right now open for applications, and you can apply for the this particular course on the MIT WPU website. So that was my time, and thank you everyone for patient listening. If there are any questions, I can take them now.
Thank you, sir. In a very short period of time, you have just covered lots of things, like how to do research, what are the opportunities and challenges pursuing career in ecology and sustainability studies. You also told us about the conservation and protection of environment, how we can contribute in that. So it's a fantastic session, very much informative and influential as well. But sir, I have a question. In present generation, current scenario, the students are doing the exam-centric studies. They are not very much fond of the research kind of thing. They don't have that scientific attitude or research attitude in them. They just do the study for exam point of view. So I have seen you 12 years back, sir. At that time also, you were just engaging with every Saturday, Sunday in the very morning, you go for bird watching. You have said that your school days triggered you to work in a field of biodiversity. But from where you get that much of enthusiasm as well as motivation to work for such a long period of time in the field as well as in the lab?
Thank you, ma'am. That was, I think, a very interesting question, I would say. It's because, you know, this is an off-track kind of a career. Okay, it's not that everyone does. So if you're choosing a career which is, you know, something called path less traveled, you need to be really sure about what, where your priorities are, what your internal interests are. Okay, if you're just taking up such a career just for the fun that you will be in the forest, then this, it's not for you actually. So as a student, you know, as a prospective student, if you have this internal liking about being in the forest, you know, observing, collecting data, putting lot many of your efforts, if you like it, then eventually you will learn the ways the data is collected, how to process it. You need to take interest in all these things. Okay. I have seen many people like who start the career with as a wildlife biologist, or, you know, they get interested in this field because I think there is a lot of glamour also associated with being a wildlife biologist. I mean, it sounds really cool when you say that I'm a wildlife biologist. So the other person really gets impressed. Oh, he's a wildlife biologist. So then the next question they ask me is, are you a Nat Geo? So there I say, no, I'm more of a local wildlife biologist. I'm not the Nat Geo wildlife biologist. So you need to understand that there is a glamour associated with it. However, I have also seen many people joining this field and eventually leaving it because they think that it's not their cup of tea, or they think that it's too hard to be on field collecting data, you know, or they also sometimes feel that, okay, so there is statistics that you have to learn. I don't want to do that. And they leave it. But eventually, those who survive, those who actually, you know, can cross these hurdles, they become very successful. And I would say that in India, in fact, globally, the whole community of ecologists is very small. So in fact, everyone knows everyone, especially in India, everyone almost knows everyone, all the other ecologists. So the people who have stayed there, they have coped up with all these resistances. There could be many, actually. It's not only about your interests. It could be an emotional thing. It could be a financial thing. It could be academic, many different fronts. Okay. So when, in fact, in any career, when you stay back, when you work on your weak areas, when you prove your mettle, then I think you become successful in that career. And then you, then when you become successful, then there are many more avenues that will open up. So you know now from here where I have to go. Next step is what? Okay, if you're just struggling there somewhere and you're finding that, you know, I like it, but I don't like it that much. So there, I think it's better you look for other type of career where you can do the best. If you're not able to do the best, then I think it's time that you switch a career.
Sir, because research is the heart of development of a society. We have to do that thing. We have to work for research so that a society can go for the betterment. And now the present generation or the current generation, they are not much very dedicated for this type of thing. So what we can do as a moderator, sir?
So as I mentioned, during my 11th and 12th, I was very fortunate to have Dr. Acharya as one of the mentors, who basically showed us, you know, the biology is more experimental. I mean, that many things that you can actually learn just by going into your backyard. So in fact, in your backyard, there is so much of information. There is so much of biodiversity. You don't really have to travel to any national park or, you know, a big wildlife sanctuary to learn. So that's the first thing. Secondly, mentors, you know, basically can take you to the field. They can show you how things are. It's up to the candidate to really discover whether they like it or not. Okay. So, I mean, many of my students who have come with me for the first time to the field, I think there is a very good percentage, around 70-80% of the students who stay back and they pursue this. Okay. They come first time when I say that I'm going for bird watching. If you want to join, you can join. So here is an option that you can join or you cannot join. And typically bird watching happens in early morning. So I know when someone joins me, you know, for bird watching early morning, then that person is serious about it. And when they see the birds around through binoculars, then they really understand what beauty this is. It's very addictive. Okay. So if they're coming again, then he's serious and he perhaps want to do a project or, you know, want to do something where he can actually learn more about it. So when we give small projects to the people, to the interns, and they put in a lot of efforts into it, they try to understand the field. So there are many students, many interns working with me, and I can really see the, you know, the kind of passion they show in their work. So they are candidate and you know, contribute to the field. So in my team, there are, I think, around 20 to 25 students altogether, and they are doing really amazing work. So as a mentor, it's also my duty to understand what are their strengths, what are their weaknesses, who is good at what. So not everyone is good at research. Some people are good at photography. Some people are good at conceptualization. Some people are good at actually collecting data, getting it to the lab. Some people are very good at analysis. So if you could sort of, you know, do this field testing first as a mentor, if you do this field testing plus where you give all the jobs to everyone and then try to understand who has strength in which area, and then you sit together with the team, you talk to them, and then you tell them that, look, I am assigning XYZ work to ABC person. And if that person is enjoying that work, I think then partially you are done as a mentor, and then they will take it from there. So there is a question from, I'll just read out. There is a question from Ryan Satish.
Yes.
And whether over your years of documenting odonates and owls, have you come across any interactions between the two? So I haven't seen any direct interactions between owls and dragonflies. That's perhaps because of their, you know, their niches, like temporality is very different. Like owls are active at night and dragonflies are active at the daytime. So perhaps that's the reason, but there are many resources that which are common to both of them. For example, water or, you know, forest, grasses, insects, and so on. So ecologically, there are interactions. However, I have not come across any direct interactions between the two. There is one more question from, I think.
Thank you, Nod, sir. Yes, from Akanksha Mahajan. Thank you so much, sir, for a plethora of knowledge you shared. Really, it takes years to achieve this level. You inspired upcoming researchers in the field of ecology. Thanks again.
Thank you, Akanksha. There is one private message I have received, but I'll read it for everyone because it's, I think it's a common question. This is by Madhuri. If someone is interested in joining your team as a project assistant or as PhD student, what can be done? So thank you, Madhuri, for this question. It's open for everyone, actually. You can check out my website. It's called chaturullu.in. I will share that with Dr. Goswami, so she can share it with all of you. You can check that website. You can see what kind of research is currently happening with the team. If you are interested in any of these research areas, then you can write to me. We can set up an interaction, and then we'll take it from there.
Definitely, Madhuri, I will help you to get connected with sir. Sir, thank you very much for the very much informative come influential session by passionate Pankaj sir. Your presentation shows how passionately and dedicatedly you are working in the last decades.
Thank you. Thank you for those sweet words.
Thank you, sir. It is indeed, we have just reached end of the session. It is indeed a great privilege and joy for me to propose vote of thanks on behalf of Goswami's Excellence Education Foundation to all those who have contributed in one way or the other to make this session of Learn from Life a great success. Thank you each and everyone for being here with us today. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you all the audiences.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks for patient listening.
Thank you, sir. Sir is very much busy and he has just make out time for us. Thanks, sir.